Our today topics, lead and lack compensation, lead and lack compensation. In our class, we may familiar with proportional control, derivative, and integral control. But in the actual implementation, maybe it's not so easy to make a perfect integral or perfect derivative. If you consider the transfer function of derivative controller and integral controller, it seems like we need to maybe put pole at infinite, or maybe we need to put zero at actual origin on the S-plane. So in the actual implementation, sometimes it's not so convenient to do that, because like we cannot precisely create the real system. So lead lag compensator, the function is similar to PD. PD and PI. For the lead compensator, it's gonna be something like controller transfer function, gonna be S plus zero dy by S plus pole. S plus zero dy by S plus pole. And we call it lead because the face of the pole and the face angle of the zero. The zero gonna be on the right hand side of the pole, and the locus of the root gonna travel from pole to zero to the right hand side, and we call it lead compensator. So the condition for lead compensator means when we consider the value of pole and zero, it should be something like maybe -2, -20, for example. So the zero gonna be smaller in the magnitude compared to the location of the pole. So magnitude of zero should smaller than the magnitude of the pole for the lead compensator. Why I try to compare the lead compensator with PD controller. Actually for PD controller, the transfer function of the controller, the form that we familiar with gonna be gain and multiply by S plus A, and we locate the A somewhere. If we plot the PD controller on the S plane, it seems like we have one zero. And how about the pole location of the PD? Maybe we should put the pole very far in infinite. It should have pole in infinite, but the one that affect the response, the dominant part of the controller that we can obviously see in the response gonna be the effect of the zero. For PI, not for PI, for the lag compensator, the form of the lag compensator and the lead compensator, the symbolic form is the same one, but I think you can guess about the magnitude of pole and zero for the lag compensator. In the lag compensator, for the lead compensator, the locus travel from the pole to the zero, to the right-hand side. For the lag compensator, we have pole and we have zero, and the locus travel from the pole to the zero, to the left-hand side, and which mean pole and zero, which mean the magnitude of the zero should be bigger than the magnitude of the pole. For the lag compensator, the magnitude of zero is bigger than the magnitude of the pole. And I try to compare the PI and the lag. For PI controller, maybe for I controller, it should be for I controller, we see K per S. In this part, if we consider it's like S minus zero. But as I mentioned, maybe we cannot precisely put the pole on the zero. But in the real implementation, we can put pole close to the zero, but not exactly at the origin. So example of the lag compensator gonna be something like this. The magnitude of the zero is more than 10 times of the magnitude of the pole, and the magnitude of the pole is very close to the origin. And the dynamic of the system due to the effect of this controller is gonna be something that happened fast. Happened very slow, but close to the zero, a small value. So today, we're gonna begin with the lead compensator. How can the lead compensator perform compared to PD controller? We know that PD controller, the advantage, it can improve the damping ratio against the increase of the gain K. So with the same gain K, without the PD controller, the system may be already unstable. But with the PD control, we still can increase the gain, but the system still stable because it have high damping ratio. And of course, when we increase the gain K, the system tend to perform faster, but it's still stable with the PD control. Today, we will see how efficient of the lead compensator compared to the PD control. And after that, as I mentioned, the lag It's similar to PI, but easier to implement. So the role of the lag compensator is to reduce the steady state error, to reduce the steady state error. And in the system, we may take advantage of both the lead and lag. We design the lead compensator first so that it can like be like the system gonna be stable and have high damping ratio when we select the gain K. And we add the lag compensator to the system so that we can achieve the desired value at steady state. Before we begin, maybe when I assigned the project to you, it seems like maybe in next semester, we may need to spend time to code Arduino so that we can balance the self-balancing system. So what is the difference between the transfer function in S domain and the continuous time? The continuous time. In this case, we only consider the controller. Of course, the plant has its own dynamics, but if we only focus on the controller, the error between the reference value and the feedback value, the error between the reference and the feedback gonna be the input of the controller. And the output of the controller gonna be the control input. By actuator. The control input by actuator will do something with our plan. And our plan with its own dynamics, it's gonna show the response of the plan. And again, we measure the response by sensor. And we compare to the reference value again. If we still have error, it's gonna be amplified by the controller, and we have the control input feed to the plan again, and the loop gonna be like this. And it depends on how big is our sampling, and the loop gonna be continue. If we consider the transfer function that relate the control input and the error for PD control. For the Laplace, PD control is again multiplied by S plus 1 parameter. And the meaning in the time domain function, for the PD controller, we're gonna have the KP that directly multiply by the error value. KP, a constant KP multiplied by the magnitude of the error at that point of time. For the KD, the role of the KD is to amplify the time derivative of the error against time, against time. So for the Laplace, in the simple form here, we're familiar with. And of course, for the continuous time function, for the continuous time function, when we introduce PD, PI controller, we already mentioned about the role of KP that multiply to the error, the role of KD that multiply by the derivative of error against time. If we have the I controller, if we have the I controller, it's gonna multiply by the error, integral of error against time. But in the actual implementation, if we need to write Arduino code and the Arduino gonna have the loop of the Arduino that it perform from the top line to the bottom line and then come back to the first line in the loop, in the void loop of Arduino again. So it depends on how fast it can perform the computation in one loop. This is the sampling time. This is a sampling time. And instead of the time, continuous time, we're gonna count the loop in the for loop. And I think you're familiar with for I equal to 1 until 10 and end of the for loop, and the I index gonna run from 1 to the final value, something like that. And yeah, in the while loop, maybe if you didn't write, if we are not going to write the for loop in the while loop, every time when it complete the loop in the while loop of Arduino, we may add a counter at the end of the loop. And this counter gonna count the number of the sampling. But the actual time in the continuous time, when we want to see how long the system already operate, we can estimate the time, the actual time, the continuous time, by multiply the number of sampling by the period or the sampling time for one loop. And of course, for the proportional control, it's not that difficult. We just multiply the gain K to the error that we can read at that in the beginning of that loop. We can multiply the KP with the error. For the derivative in the discrete time. For the derivative in the discrete time, they just compute the difference between the error in the current loop minus the error in the previous loop. And to see the rate of change of the error in the current loop compared to the previous loop. And we can estimate the derivative of the error by this way in the discrete time system. If our sampling is more enough, maybe 1 microsec or maybe 10 microsec, and our system time constant, the dynamic response of the system have big time constant, but our controller is fast enough, we are not going to have a problem with the discrete time computation. But in some case, the system dynamics is fast, the time constant is more. Time constant in the continuous time system is more, but we cannot perform the fast computation enough. We cannot complete the loop within a small sampling time. At that case, we're gonna have the problem with the with the discrete time estimation. And instead of the Laplace transform, actually we have the C transform for discrete time problem when the sampling is not that small compared to the time constant of the dynamic system. Okay, so this slide is only one slide that we reveal the idea of the continuous time system and how can we try to control continuous time system with a discrete time controller. But what we are going to see in today's class, maybe it's going to be a new topic, not relating to this one. This one is just one review for you. So in the beginning of the class today, I introduced the lead compensator. And actually our plan or system is just the GS. The K here, the K or the gain K, we can consider the gain K multiplied to the Planck transfer function, or we can consider the gain K multiplied to the controller. The controller is the same, It's not a big deal. We can consider K already multiplied to the system transfer function, or we don't have K here, but have the K at this point and multiply to the controller. In the actual meaning, the K should multiply to the controller. And the Planck transfer function is just the Planck transfer function. But in this slide, we multiply K to the Planck transfer function because we are going to use the root locus method. So in the root locus method, we have the open loop transfer function and we vary the gain K and see how the root of the characteristic equation shift on the S plane with the increase of the gain K, So in this system, maybe if we try to plot the root locus, if we try to sketch the root locus of this system, of the GS, do we have zero or pole in this system? We don't have zero in this system, right? How about the pole of this system? We have the pole. We have the pole at zero and minus one. If we need to plot the root locus of this system, we know that the pole, when we increase the gain K, the locus gonna be on the left-hand side of the odd pole. And when the locus from each pole hit with each other, it's gonna be break away. And we're gonna have asymptote for this root locus. And the angle of the asymptote, if we have two pole and we have one, we have zero, zero. We have no zero and we have two pole. We know that the asymptote of the locus gonna make 90 degree at the intersection point to the real axis. So in this case, the breakaway point gonna be in the middle, and the asymptote gonna follow the 90 degree, the vertical line. And in this case, here is the locus. And when we increase the gain K, the system gonna go higher. The root of the system gonna go higher. Means when it go higher with this angle, the damping ratio will small. Here, damping ratio equal to 1. In the vertical line, the damping ratio, wait a second. In the vertical line, imaginary axis, damping ratio 0. In the real axis, damping ratio equal to 1. And the damping ratio will decrease when we increase the gain K. What's gonna happen if we add the PD control, or if we add the lead compensator to this system? The original system have the root locus line like this. If we add the PD controller, here, we're gonna add 1, 0. And the location of the 0 gonna be at -2. So maybe the system, instead of have the vertical line asymptote, when the root break away from the breakaway point, it's gonna make a circle and have the break in, and one root gonna travel to a 0 here, and another root gonna go to the 0 at minus infinite. What we can see when we add the PD controller is, instead of when we increase the gain K, the root just go upper along the vertical asymptote. But if we add a 0, by the PD controller, we change the root locus plot. Instead of go along the vertical asymptote, it need to travel as a circle and then come back to the real axis at the break-in point. Here is the breakaway. How about instead of the PD, but we add the lead compensator instead of the PD? The 0 at -2, we still have the 0 at -2, but the pole, instead of the pole at infinite, we have another pole at -20. In the root locus plot, the 0 try to add some, without the 0, the root locus go along the vertical asymptote. With a 0 and a pole at -infinite, we see the break in point we see the break in point if we have a pole if we have a pole at minus 20 instead of minus infinite what we are going to see is the same we still see the locus of the root on the left hand side of the first pole and the third one on the real axis the locus going to be here and here and yeah we still see the break in and break away we still see the break in and break away but the position of the break in and breakaway point may be slightly different compared to the PD control compared to the PD control in the locus plot the zero try to pull the locus to it if we don't have a zero if we don't have a pole here if we don't have a pole here this going to be come to the zero but if we have a pole here the pole try to push the locus away from it pole try to push the locus away from it the zero try to pull the locus to it here is when we sketch the root locus by hand because this example is not so difficult we have only two pole and we don't have zero when we use MATLAB 2 the GS is 1 per S plus 1 the GS is 1 per S plus 1 and the MATLAB you can just only use the transfer function and 1 per s power 2 plus s power 1 and 0 s power 0 1 1 0 or when you use the convolution means transfer function 1 per s plus 0 multiplied by s plus 1 I show two possible way now to compose the transfer function 1 per s multiplied by s plus 1 you can use convolution or you just write down the coefficient of the polynomial in the denominator of the transfer function the coefficient 1 1 0 coefficient 1 1 0 and the transfer function is equivalent with the one that we are going to plot the root locus to plot the root locus you use only one command root locus of the sys for plotting the root locus open loop transfer function be careful open loop transfer function and when we plot the root locus in today's class in all example in today's class I will focus on the damping ratio equal to 0.7.7 I hope you still remember the characteristic of second order system the damping ratio 0.7 will make the system to behave as fast as possible but still don't have the overshoot and in this system we have the pole at zero and the pole s minus 1 and the root locus is as we sketched in the beginning. We're gonna have the breakaway point and one root will go upper, another root will go downward. And when we pick the root, that corresponds to the damping ratio 0.7. At this point, the gain K, that corresponds to the location of the pole is equal to 0.5, And this is only proportional control. We can pick the gain K equal to 0.5. And in this controller, proportional controller, we can have a system that have damping ratio 0.7 and the speed of the system gonna be the real value. And the speed of the system gonna be the natural frequency. The speed of the system gonna be 0.7 also. But this is just the original system. How about the PD? For the PD, the sys still be the same with this one, okay? Sys still be sys is 1 per s plus 1. And for the PD, controller one, this is 1, okay? Not L, 1. The controller one, transfer function of the controller one. Transfer function of the controller one is S plus 2 divided by 1, which is S plus 2. The controller one is S plus 2. Sys open loop one, open loop. Sys open loop one is controller multiplied by the sys. The transfer function of the open loop gonna be S plus 2 multiplied by 1 per S plus 1. I compose the open loop 1 because when I need to plot the root locus, I need to use the open loop transfer function. And in this root locus, it's not the root locus of only the system, but it's the open loop of the controller multiplied by the system plan transfer function. And as we try to sketch, we have the pole, and we have the zero. In this case, the zero gonna be at minus 2. And the pole gonna be equal to 0 and minus 1. The pole at 0, the pole at minus 1, the pole at minus 1. And the zero at minus 2. If you still remember, the original system. In the original system, the asymptote cross the real axis at minus 0.5, exactly between the pole, the two pole, exactly in the middle between the two pole. But if we have a zero in the system, if we have a zero in the system, the effect of the zero is it's trying to pull the locus. So I think the breakaway point here slightly shift from minus 0.5 to the left hand side. You can confirm in the MATLAB when you plot this, but I think it's gonna slightly shift to the left hand side from the position 0.5. And we have the breakaway. We have a breakaway and we have a break in. And in this system, we have two pole and we have one zero. So one locus gonna travel to the zero at minus two. Another locus will travel to the zero at minus infinite, at minus infinite. And again, when I need to pick the root location, the root of the characteristic equation that gonna describe the behavior of our system, I focus on the damping ratio 0.7. I focus on the damping ratio 0.7. But in this case, the gain that we can achieve that damping ratio is 0.98 compared to original system. In the original system, when we increase the gain K to 0.5, the damping ratio already be 0.7. If we still increase the gain K, the damping ratio will be small. And the system tend to be like have extreme vibration and tend to unstable. So with the PD control, we still can increase the gain K. But the system still maintain the desired damping ratio, maintain the desired percentage of the overshoot, maintain the desired damping ratio. In terms of speed, because when we add the zero, the root locus travel to the left hand side instead of go in the vertical line. When we go to the left hand side, it means we increase the speed. So the benefit of PD control is we still can allow higher K while maintain damping ratio. Higher K means higher speed. Higher K and higher, when we increase gain K, it's gonna be go with higher omega n. Higher gain K higher speed but still maintain the damping ratio with the PD control, with the PD control. How about the lead compensator? The lead compensator for PD control, the transfer function S plus two, S plus two for PD, the transfer function of the controller is S plus two divided by S plus infinite. We have 1 0 at minus two, and we have 1 pole at minus infinite. But for the lead compensator, for the lead compensator, instead of having a pole at infinite, we define a pole at 1 point. And at that point, actually, you know, the original system have the pole as zero and have the pole as minus one. The original system have the pole as zero and minus one. When we implement the lead compensator, my recommend is select the pole maybe more than 20 times in magnitude of the original system. We cannot put it at the infinite. But we know that the pole try to push the locus to the right hand side. The pole try to push the locus to the right hand side. If we put it as far as possible, the perfect case, we put the pole at infinite. But if we cannot put it at infinite for PD, we try to put it as far as possible. My suggestion is maybe like 20 times so that we don't have the effect of the pole that try to push the locus to the right-hand side. If we zoom in this picture and see only this, you know, maybe it's the same with this picture. If we zoom in, it's the same with this picture, but if we not zoom in, the locus of the root gonna be have the breakaway point again. We have first breakaway point, and we have break in. At the break in, one locus gonna go to the zero, another one will go to the minus infinite. But if we count the number of the pole and zero on the real axis, the locus gonna be on the left hand side of the first pole and zero. And why we have this, we may need to go back to check the asymptote. It seems like now we have 1, 2, and 3. We have 3 0, or we have 3 pole, and we have 1 0. We have 3 pole and we have 1 0. So the asymptote need to be plus and minus 90 degree. Asymptote need to be plus and minus 90 degree. But for the PD control, we have 1 0 and we have two pole. N minus m, the number of pole subtract by number of zero is equal to one. So for the PD control, we have only one asymptote at 180 degree. But for the lead compensator, N minus M equal to two. So we have two asymptotes. We have two asymptotes in plus and minus 90 degree, plus and minus 90 degree. So for sketch the root locus, for sketch the root locus and the, how to say, the shape of the locus is like this. But why we need to plot the root locus of this system? Of this system, the way I plot is the same in with the previous slide. In the previous slide, I begin with the sys controller one. Sys controller two is the transfer function of this divided by this for the controller two. For the controller two, the open loop two. The open loop two is the controller two multiplied by the original system. Original system. So in this case, the controller two is the lead compensator S plus two divided by S plus 20, the lead compensator, and the sys original system. And then we vary the gain K. We vary the gain K. We vary the gain K. And the characteristic equation, the root of characteristic equation will change along the root locus. When we plot the root locus, again, we use the open loop transfer function. We use the open loop transfer function. And we sketch the root locus, and I focus on damping ratio 0.7 again. But what we achieve here, in this case, when the gain K, no, when we need to achieve the damping ratio, damping ratio 0.7, the gain K, that's still secure, the damping ratio is 31. It's 31. Significantly bigger than 0.98 and 0.5. With the lead compensator, we can select a higher gain K, By selecting the higher gain K, benefit is the speed, higher gain, we get higher speed, Now in this three slide, you begin from, the system have only proportional controller, The system have K S plus two. The system has the controller K S plus two divided by S plus 20. In this three slide, you can find the gain K that make the system have the damping ratio 0.7 by root locus method. You can find the gain K that make the system have the desired damping ratio. It means you already design a controller for system. If you select proportional controller, you already know the gain K for proportional controller. You already know the gain K if you use the PD. You already know the gain K if you use the lead compensator by plot the root locus that use the open loop transfer function. You already decide the gain K. How to confirm? How can we confirm that the response of the system is as we expect? Is as we expect. We need to plot the actual response. We need to plot the actual response. I should ask you about the type of the system, the type of the system. Maybe I'm gonna be very happy if we have one volunteer to tell me the system type. Do you have any idea for this system type? Type 0, type 1, or type 2? Okay, thank you, Arada. The system is the system type 1 because we have an independent S here in the denominator, in the denominator. A system type 1, if we have the input, if we have unit step as input, if we have unit step as input, for a system type 1, we don't have problem. We're gonna achieve the zero steady state error for system type 1. And when the input is unit step. But if the input is RAM function, maybe we're gonna have the error at steady state. It means maybe when the reference value of unit lamp reference, if we have a reference value for unit lamp, maybe our system gonna have error in the value for our RAM. But 100% with the system type 1, if the input is just a step, we're gonna see something like this, but finally, the steady state error gonna be zero for the system type 1. So in this, to see the performance of this system, instead of plot the unit step plot, I plot a unit lamp response. But why? I use unit lamp, but why? You can see the step here. It's not a mistake. I'm gonna explain you. I always understand that we have step sys and we should have something like RAM. Sys, but MATLAB don't have the RAM function to plot the RAM. But the idea is the output divided by the input is the transfer function, the cross loop transfer function. Output divided by input. The reference, the controller, the plan, and the output. also the sensor. The output divided by input is the closed loop transfer function. Closed loop, be careful, it's not just use the controller multiplied by the plan. The controller multiplied by the plan is open loop transfer function. If we want to find the closed loop transfer function, we need to use feedback. And the transfer function of the forward part and the feedback. Actually, for the closed loop, we can use this. Closed loop transfer function in the MATLAB can be obtained by type the function name feedback. And our sys is this one. And our feedback, the sensor transfer function equal to 1. In this slide, I try to use the command step, but plot the ramp response. I use the command step, but plot the ramp response. How can I do that? We know that for a step response, the input is equal to 1 per S, but for the ramp, the input is 1 per S square, 1 per S square. The method that I try to plot the step, no, I try to plot the ramp by use the MATLAB step function. I just multiply the closed loop transfer function by one per S. I just multiply the closed loop transfer function by 1 per S. And then use the step for this. For the step, yeah, we're gonna add 1 per S, but we already multiply 1 per S to the closed loop transfer function. We already multiply the 1 per S to the closed loop transfer function. And we just use the step for this. I think you already got some hint. If your input is parabolic, if your input is parabolic, you may need to multiply the closed loop transfer function by 1 per S square first, and then use the step to plot the response to parabolic input. And for the original system means we only have the plan or the system and the controller gonna be equal to 1, no gain k equal to 1, no proportional gain just equal to 1, and plot the original system. When we plot the original system, that respond to a ramp input It's gonna be in the blue line. We have some error between the blue line and the reference RAM input. Reference RAM input. For P control. For P control. If we want to achieve the steady state, if we want to achieve the damping ratio 0.7, if we want to achieve damping ratio 0.7 and use proportional controller, the gain K should be 0.5. The gain K should be 0.5. So the gain K here equal to 0.5. And just multiply to the 6 and to find the closed loop, we use the command feedback. The sensor is 1. after we have the closed loop transfer function, don't forget to multiply by 1 per s, because we're gonna use step command to find the RAM response. For the proportional control, the error is bigger than the original system. Which makes sense, because for the original system, the gain K equal to 1. For the proportional, if we still need to secure the requirement of the damping ratio 0.7, the gain can only be 0.5, which is smaller than 1. With a smaller gain, it tend to have higher steady state error, have lower response. But if we compare the performance between these two systems, maybe in terms of vibration, the P controller that we can guarantee the damping ratio 0.7 may be better than the original system. The original system, when the K equal to 1, when the K is equal to 1, maybe somewhere higher, and the damping ratio will less than 0.7. Damping ratio will less than 0.7, which means we may see overshoot. If you see the lamp, I'm not sure if we can try to draw. Draw the linear line. For the system with P control, and we can guarantee the damping ratio 0.7, we are not going to see the overshoot. But for damping ratio less than 0.7 in the original system, we can see this part of the overshoot. How about for the PD control? For the PD control, the gain 0.982, and the sys open loop one, sys 01. So 0.982 multiply by 601. 601 here is the controller multiplied by the system, multiplied by the system. 601 is controller 1 multiplied by system. Controller 1 is the PD control. And again, for the PD control, it's 0.98, so that we can have the damping ratio 0.7. For PD control, the response is plot in the orange one. We still have some steady state error, For the lead compensator, 602 means this controller multiplied by the original system. We have 602, open loop 2. And again, for the controller, we can have the gain 31.4. So we have 31.4 multiplied by the 602 and have the feedback so that we have the closed loop transfer function. And we multiply by 1 per S because we want to use the step command to obtain the RAM response, Finally, in this case, the lead compensator give the best response. The lead compensator give the best response, even better than the PD. But our controller, in this case, we still have the steady state error. To the RAM input. We're gonna see the potential at the end of today's class. We're gonna see the potential of the lag compensator to deal with this problem. How can the lag compensator improve the steady state error to the lead system? So we already done with the lead. Next step, we will see the lag compensator. And at the end of the class, we're gonna add the lag to the lead system. Okay. So maybe I think we can have a break for 10 minutes before we continue with the lag. Let's have 10 minute break and come back by 2:35.